So I think, you know, I know all of us would like to thank Mr. Mantha for having moderated what must have been and continues to be and will hopefully not remain for eternity one of the most difficult subjects in education policy, which is regulation and quality assurance. And I say this only because very briefly, and I'll say this in exactly one line, unless we have clarity on end objectives, this document will not achieve what India requires. And there'll be a huge mismatch between expectations, demands, and final achievables. So we need to know why we want the education policy to do what we say it ought to do. And then the strategy can fall into place. To move on specifically to the subject, which is on the internationalization of education, research, innovation, and new knowledge. I'll speak only for about 5 minutes, and then we can have a more detailed discussion. I think internationalization is a two-way process. So this is the first point I'd like to make. Second, there is a massive demand-supply mismatch in India. Even if we were to achieve the 30% gross enrollment rate that we would like to achieve in tertiary education, 100 million students who are eligible for admission in universities would not get admission. I think this demand-supply mismatch is a critical component that we need to keep in mind. Third, our delivery platform needs to undergo a transformative change. Today, through the Swayam platform, it is being assumed that MOOCs and online would be the answer. I'm not entirely certain that evidence demonstrates that online education has a very high success rate in terms of completion. It is therefore important for us to critically ask the next question, which I tell you is a fact again. By 2025, India needs 1,000 new universities, 55,000 new polytechnics, and 1 million new teachers. How are we supposed to produce this? I mean, all of you have been in the world of academia. Do we produce teachers from a supermarket? And I think this means it's not just the right to education, it's the right to quality education, which is the point that Professor Mantha was trying to make by saying education and employability. Only quality education will create the person for the future. To my mind, therefore, we need to ask ourselves whether the education system should undergo fundamental liberalization, given the fact that this crisis is not something that we are going to face 30 years later, but we are deep in it. And by liberalization, I mean opening up to platforms available abroad. I'll give you an example. I'm again talking about quality platforms. I represent the University of New South Wales. For every 1,200 Chinese students who join every year, 340 Indian students join. The 1,200 Chinese students are fully funded by the Chinese government. The 300 odd students are fully funded by their parents. That's the difference. And China faced the same problem when it decided that I have to build so many universities, get so many teachers, it's much more economically efficient for me to fund my students to go abroad and study. That's what it did. Now we need to ask ourselves, how are we going to cater to this massive supply constraint? This is the core question to my mind. And if we are going to take, if the IITs, for example, which are the premium, the Indian Institute of Science, the premium, IIMs, this is the creme de la creme we are talking about. If we are going to start flooding, the limited faculty with more and more students, the time you spend and engage with each student is going to qualitatively suffer. Your research programs will undergo a major transformation negatively. We need to therefore ask ourselves, what exactly does internationalization of education mean? If you go abroad, and if I go to UNSW, and I say, okay, let's have an MOU with one of the Indian institutions, they say, if it's engineering, it's only IIT. If it's architecture, it's School of Planning and Architecture. If it's design, it has to be National Institute of Design. You go to each one of them. Believe me, the IITs and everyone have hundreds of MOUs which are dormant. They are dormant. Is this internationalization? So what exactly are we talking about? How do we invest, for example, in stellar organizations like HR College, or there are so many of them, absolutely outstanding in the areas of economics, management, design, architecture? How do we upgrade them? At the same time, how do we not put all the eggs in the upgrading of Indian domestic institutions? How do we expand? Believe me, the crisis is very, very real. We are going to, as the Honorable President said, your demographic dividend will become a demographic liability. And I don't think I need to say this to anyone. If you have a young, unemployed population, it is historically correlated with crime. And today, your biggest crime is the availability by non-state actors. It is a huge problem. You know the problem across the globe. This is a genuine crisis, and it's a crisis of our making. We are already 30 years too late in dealing with it. And if India is to capitalize on its growth story, the biggest contributor to growth as a multiplier is good quality education. It's inescapable. So with just these points, let me stop. Let me also say that research is not just curiosity. Science is not just curiosity. It is the application of curiosity for commercial use, even if it is for social reasons. One of IIT Bombay's alumni is a professor of high distinction in the University of New South Wales. She is in fact going to give a distinguished lecture at IIT Bombay soon. This is Professor Veena Sahajwala. And I'll just tell one little story about her to tell you what internationalization of research is in my view. When everyone considered something useless and threw it away, even from her IIT Bombay days, she used to collect it. Because she felt that that mobile phone which you can no longer use has something in it which can be removed and converted. The rubber tire which you burn has some elements in it which can be converted. You can Google her. She has created something called green steel. Entire cities in Australia and East Asia are being made from waste products. To my mind, research, which is a curiosity-based and driven aspiration, got a commercial relationship. It is transforming the way it is looking at it. It is impacting environment because you don't burn the rubber tire anymore. You convert that rubber tire into steel. You don't take your mobile phones and other gadgets which you can't use. You convert that into green steel. UNSW is the world leader on photovoltaic cells and solar energy. It is number one in the world. Can it get into collaboration in order to transform the fact that India is today not a signatory to the climate change dialogue, and the Prime Minister's entire commitment is to make India a solar energy-driven country? It is possible. All of this is possible. But the question is, how do we look at higher education and foreign collaboration? So with having said this 5-minute Indian stretchable time, which went on for 10 minutes, shall I start with you, ma'am?
Thank you. what from the perspective of a teacher, just I feel that if before starting out new universities or which are at par with international universities, first expose the educators to foreign universities. Means problem is the teachers or the we are stuck in that salary structure. That even to get a salary, some colleges don't even get salary. So in from where do we get that funding? Okay, I want to do a two-year internship in some abroad university. IITs have their CEP programs, which many teachers go to, but not everyone does. So compulsorily, if they are allowed to go out and look at the world, then when they come back, then the change will happen. Like, we are like kuwe ka mendak. We do have no exposure of what happens in other institutes, which are at very high level. So first, the educators need to be exposed to foreign universities, then the change slowly will start to percolate. This is my viewpoint.
So I would like to, about the internationalization, I have slightly different views. I have some data. The foreign exchange outgo on account of higher education alone would have come to staggering 48,124.8 crore every year. You divide that by the 1 million teachers whom we have to generate and pay that as their salary, they will get fantastic salary. And Indians are known to be good teachers all over the world. An example was given. I have seen that in the US. I have seen it all over the place. So I think we should think about internationalizing. I would think about, can we improve our education and make it international so that we can attract many more people from overseas? And they pay our salaries. Because at present, we end up paying high salaries of faculty members. Okay? I have done some statistics. I don't have the numbers now. But I thought I would do the calculation once more. I've done these calculations about 10 years ago. The other important point was, does this education policy have any objective? That's a very valid point. In fact, I would even ask the question of, should we worry about, because there is a question of research innovation as one of the things. And what is the problem, what is affecting research innovation right now? That is something that I would want to talk about. At one time, in a place like IIT, you didn't, at least in the early days, anybody who wanted to study could get in, clear the exam. I mean, at some point. I don't think there were many people who went through coaching and so on. They could get in. Those were the days when IIT brand was not so well known, right? And I would say that in order to get into IIT now, one needs to prepare from sixth grade onwards. And of course, many other people, and we, as I mentioned earlier, it's an elimination process. We reject 99% of the people. The 1% of the people who get into IIT say, I've got into IIT, what else do I need? So where is research innovation? They can't. They have been educated, they have been taught how to get into IIT. But they can solve any problem, but can they come up with a question that, you know, what is the problem to be solved? Because our overemphasis on this, narrow, very few higher institutions of higher learning at the top end, there is a serious problem. This is happening in every field that I mentioned earlier. So I would even ask this question of, should we not worry about getting good quality education at 12th grade? Is it possible for us to say that everybody who has finished 12th will get a minimum 5,000 rupee salary or something better? If we say that is our objective, India will become a developed country. Everybody who has finished 12th gets a 5,000 rupee salary or something better. they want to do bachelor's degree, BA, BSc, BCom, that's fine. But they have an option of, you know, some salary and somebody is going to eat at home. So if that is the case, is it easy to achieve or difficult to achieve? In my opinion, it's actually quite difficult. It is easier for us to send somebody to a rocket to Mars and so on, but giving drinking water to everybody is a serious problem. It is easier to start 10 IITs, 20 IITs, but it is difficult to get good quality education at a lower level. And I believe that if this is not addressed, this research innovation is going to be a problem. We will produce, we have IITs as islands of excellence amongst ruins. This is a problem. Where is research innovation? And finally, we have to take students from these people. So anyway, I think that more democratization of good quality education at the lower level is extremely important. Unless we do that, research innovation cannot happen. And I also don't think that we need PhDs to produce good bachelor's level people at any level, given that there is a far cry. We should first solve the problem of BTECs not teaching BTECs, BSc students, graduates not teaching BSc graduates. Let us go for the next level. Can we say that master's level people are required, good quality? If we do that, then we can produce lots of teachers. That can be done in India. We don't have to pay the exorbitant amount of tuition that is required to study overseas. Thank you.
Yeah. A lot of things can be said about this. In the sense that there are certain, being an administrator, there's a different point of view. In academician, there's a different point of view, and so on. But before looking at internationalization of education and research, it's much better to look at what is happening to research in the country and what ails that process. And where do we need, how do we go to look at the other? Some years back, there was a bill, Higher Foreign Education Providers Bill, which never passed. But then during that time, people were saying that Georgia Tech wanted to come here, you know, different universities wanted to come here and so on, but nobody came here. The point is, what is the value? If you cannot provide a value for them to come here, nobody will come. Therefore, the question is, what is this internationalization of education that we are talking about? If you exchange of faculty, students, and things like that, which is happening, doesn't work out like that. Last year, I believe, there was a scheme which is still running where the government will fund professors to come from the other institutions and teach in Indian institutions. That program is called Gyan. Now the point is, I do not want, there is a fundamental flaw with that process. I do not want a professor to come here and teach, take a lecture for 2 days, 3 days, and go back. That's neither here nor there. That is what is happening with the industry today. I say there is industry collaboration, two people come from there, take some lectures, and go back. Nothing happens. I would like to see a professor coming from, let's say, Georgia Tech, being with me for one full semester, taking one full course, interacting with my students, getting onto projects, and you fund that. Who funds that is a different issue. Conceptually, that should happen, and not one-off visit here, one-off visit there. Then you go there for 2 days, so it becomes I scratch your back, you scratch my back kind of thing at government expense. So that's what is happening in as far as the education part is concerned. Now, research is a very much more involved thing, and innovation is even much more involved. In research today, there are a lot of debates of a good research institution that also does education, a good education institution that also does research, kind of debates are there. Whatever that is. People say if there is good research background, he tends to teach better because that experience would come and things like that. Maybe that's true. So therefore you need teachers who do a lot of research and but then the research is always in a very narrow area where I am interested and things like that. And I'm not going to teach only that and not do anything else. So those kind of issues are there. So therefore the research part must be looked at very differently, and it needs a lot of money. A lot of funding is required. For example, I have good people in my institute who can, in order to get a good wind tunnel, I need 5 crore rupees. Where do I get it? I get a bench model for 20 lakh rupees or 25 lakh rupees. What do I do with that? And all my funding that I get will only support that. So research, saying that research has to happen, is fine, but it has to be supported by several boundary conditions. In addition to that, the research, I had something in mind. Yeah, we seem to produce, whether it's IITs or whichever institute we talk about, there are a lot of papers published, and today we have APIs which talk about how many papers you publish. So therefore there's a mad rush to do something and publish a paper. So this is happening. And the other dimension to this is, in order to push this activity, there are any number of new journals which are coming in. You know, IJ and whatever, that J business is becoming absolutely difficult to control. So there are papers published within 2 days' time. I send a paper, it's published 3 days later. So what review happens, what happens, God knows. So therefore both these things are happening. In this kind of environment, internationalization is a whole lot of big question mark. What needs to happen is all research leading to productization, which doesn't seem to happen here at all. We seem to publish papers. They are very good researchers in IIT. They are very good contacts. They are very well known outside. But their area of research that they do, how many products have they created? Now that's very, very difficult to answer. So we remain a consumer society. A China will come and make their mobile plants in India and make money, but they will not bring a big power plant to support industries here. So those kind of things happen. Now the only question is, we need to move towards a model that Germany adopts. I mean, this is again subject to whatever. We have universities which we have administratively classified as central, state, private, deemed to be all that. In Germany, there are only two kinds of universities. One is Max Planck. The other one is based on Fraunhofer model. Now, Max Planck basically does basic fundamental research, which supports the Fraunhofer model. And they do research only for products, creating products. So therefore, unless our research goes towards creating products, your internationalization and competing in the outside market becomes extremely untenable. So, and innovation is a different thing. And today we also hear about the government wanting to create research and innovation university, as the research is a commodity. I mean, you can do something with that. It doesn't happen like that. It needs a lot of, we all understand. And in the same breath, people talk about world-class university. I still want to know, what is a world-class university? I mean, how do you go and create a world-class university? How do you create an IIT? There are so many new IITs have come up with nothing. They shouldn't be there in the first place. I mean, what is that? Does IIT mean you can create with that brand many more. And if I call something IIT, it becomes IIT. So these are, all these things matter in professionalization, because what is the idea that you are throwing out to the people? So that's the, thank you.
Yeah, so actually, if you look at the NEP, it is actually dominated by a different thought process than from what Amit has said. So I think that they look at it from rankings and, you know, collaborations with the high-end elite universities. So if you look at it, even for Gyan, they want, you know, from the top 200 universities and so on. So I think their linkage is not with, you know, New South Wales or basic, you know, how are we going to have the, you know, so 300 universities and so on. It is really at the high end that they are looking at. That said, you see that what Amit said is very important, that what do our students, they get from an international university? I think they get some honesty, some rigor, notion of rigor, what is rigor, and what is scientific temper. So I think these are qualities which we should learn. It is not really about, you know, it is really an approach to learning, approach to education and so on. I think at the same time, you know, we should also look at this Gyan model or the higher, very elite, you know, I think there's a lot of rents there, you know, all the MIT and Harvard. They are essentially, you know, big science itself is a big project, which we should look at very carefully. It is not clear that big science is going to benefit all of us, and that it will not create its own rentiers and elite journals, Nature and so on, for which publishing in those journals or access to those journals is very difficult. So I think that membership in this elite international circle is going to be very difficult, so we should be very careful about that angle. I think even for the you know, the non-elite international education, I think you know, the Chinese approach was for teachers. They, all those students who are probably going away for teachers, and our students don't want to go and come back as teachers. So there is a serious aspirational dysfunction here. Really, our kids are looking for white collar jobs when we are consuming only 56 kilos of steel per capita. Right, so even for that green steel which was produced, you know, our nation needs to industrialize, and all these, you know, all these jobs what our kids are looking for are, you know, farmer kids looking for white collar jobs and so on, and that simply is not, you know, what these you know, so we, 10 years from now, maybe we'll have a lot of you know, lakhs and lakhs of internationally educated students who will still have no jobs here. So that is possible. So I think the aspirational dysfunction part needs to be looked at, that the incentives are very different. Next, I think that, you know, so I have already talked about quality. So there is, you know, we are living on borrowed rigor. You know, there is, IIT system has not produced a single journal in which we can report quality work, which is on relevant subjects. So that we have to recognize. So international is perforce, you know, forced upon us because we have no other notion of rigor or of quality. And also that, you know, empirical systems, it is not that IIT or no university, if you look at New South Wales or if you look at, say, Waterloo, they know about their country or their culture, the history of, say, the public transport systems in Canada. These universities are actually repositories of that knowledge. And that knowledge is the basis for producing new knowledge. So unless our universities really start accumulating knowledge or data or history, we are not going to, you know, I think we need to do it ourselves. So I think that the empirical systems which other universities have, we should learn. Then last, a few more points. So there is also another part. I think if you look at where are the jobs. So as Professor Kandan said, drinking water. Now we have a system with two engineers per tehsil. A tehsil has 100 villages. Now, are our students going to go out and internationalization lead to more taluka drinking water engineers? No. So are they going to, you know, what about community and culture? Are our systems going to function without community and culture? Is international going to improve our social science? Our social science education is dysfunctional. It has not created a single new protocol after the, you know, PRA of participatory rural analysis of 1970s. There's very few social science protocols, which, for example, even our notion of gender studies is borrowed. You know, our women spend most of the time in the well or in the chula, but that is not part of our gender studies education. So where are we going to, you know, I think that unless we really fix
these basic notions of empirics and accumulation of quality or, you know, of rigor and of what really matters and of where are the jobs going to be, of the role of community and culture and how society and technology and social sciences integrate. I think internationalization would be plugging ourselves in into an elite system, you know, where MIT will always be at the top, Harvard will be there. And I don't really about rankings. I mean, we are a state-funded, IIT is a state-funded. We should firmly say we cannot, you know, internationalize the last thing on our agenda. You know, our mandate, which was set in 1958, has a very different agenda. Even for JNU, has a very JNU, the agenda of JNU does say something about international, you know. But that is not the ranking. And, you know, now these ranking companies itself say, now you're doing better, you have more internet. I mean, it's a market which they have created, which you have to ascribe to. I think it's a, I think the NEP really is talking about something else. You know, it is about this high-end ranking business. And if you look at the Washington Accord, for example, you know, Washington Accord actually allows for a lot more liberal notion of an engineer, which we have not used. It says that engineer is a social change agent. We have not used that. So I think that, you know, existing spaces for, you know, understanding what are good things about international universities and trying to enforce them here would be a good job. I think just to 1903, the English government had talked about, you know, international, or rather whatever, the school curriculum. They set the school limit. No. Okay, so. They said, for example, that the. Well, let me then stop it, because if there's a limit, then we should.
The time of
Curzon.
Curzon's time.
Yeah. So maybe, you know, he said that, for example, there was a very interesting statement that. Yeah, and that he said that the village map should be the basis of school education. The revenue map, the village revenue, what are the basic assets? So even our college engineering students don't know how to read a revenue map. What are they going to do? How is international going to help us? I don't know.
Quick interruption, just before you begin, ma'am. If we can have some suggestions also on how these collaborations that the policy suggests are going to happen, how these collaborations must happen, how will they help or will they not help? Should foreign institutions be coming and setting up their campuses in India? So if you get something on some suggestions on those points as well. Thank you.
Yeah. So apparently we are running short of time.
But
so
we
start
So thank you, Milan. So I just want to. I don't have much to say, but I just want to point out, like, around 20, 25 years back, who are the people who are going to foreign universities? So if you just say most of the IIT graduates were going. They were going for higher studies, for MS or for earning PhD. And now you look at the situation. So internationalization has happened even at the school level. We have now so many schools with international, you know, IB schools, and which are following international curriculum. So why you know, this has happened only maybe over the last 10 years? So I think because of our education, people have lost faith. I don't know why, but maybe people have lost faith in our education system. So they want their children to study in international schools. And if they study in an international school, they will get they have a better chance to go to Ivy League schools in the US. So if you take the elite class, most of them are sending their children, even at the undergraduate level, to foreign universities. And they are all funded by the parents, as you correctly said. The parents are funding their education. And this was not the case 15, 20 years back. And I don't know now if such young children, if they go and study abroad, whether they will come back to India. That is a big question. And so the quality of education, we have to improve the quality of education even at the school level. Then only like students will stay back and they will contribute to the Indian, they will help solve the problems which we are facing. So if, so that is one thing which I want to say, that a lot of international schools have come up in the last 10 years, and this is something which is worryful, like, so. That's it. I somewhat feel that some of our fears regarding internationalization is quite, I think, not well founded, because we are in a globalized era and we need global citizens, we need global employees, and we have to understand the need to connect with the world. And I feel that somewhere internationalization is going to resolve a lot of our quality-related issues. And so when we bring them in, we do learn a lot from them in terms of what could be the parameters of quality education, as they have been able to maintain certain standards, which we have not been able to. And I think by give and take process, we could come to a consensus on what is implementable in India, and then work around an objective to achieve that. Second is that internationalization as a marker of status symbol in the society, that's a different thing. But I think in terms of research, innovation, or continuous learning, I see a lot of scope in internationalization. And this could need not be only institution affiliated. There could be independent body and centers of learning for any citizen of any age group interested in upgrading his skill, talent, or knowledge, or pursuing a passion which he has sort of given up early in life. I think we should have opportunities for that. And I think the document does talk about continuous learning. And this continuous learning cannot be only institution affiliated. It has to be certain independent centers also. Third thing is that I think there is a little bias around research, that research largely implies in terms of technical terms we talk about or technical streams. So the social science research component is highly neglected, because here there is a lot of possibility of collaborations, and we could really do a lot of, I think, path-breaking research can be brought about by these collaborations in terms of management degrees, in terms of mass media collaborations. We could have in liberal arts, for which there's so much of demand nowadays. So many students are inclined towards international relations, conflict and peace studies. So these are the upcoming fields which I think today have a lot of possibility, when even tourism for that matter, travel and tourism management, and various kinds of niche tourism which are very much in New Zealand, Australia and all. So we could have a huge lot of collaborations here. And the other factor which I see is that the nature of the programs. So the nature of the programs has to be at all levels, I feel. It should be at the undergraduate level, it should be at the postgraduate level, and it should be also at the research level, the possibility of tying up with the research. As I see in the document, there is a proposal to integrate UG, PG and doctoral. There's a proposal to integrate the whole process. And I see a very strong possibility where international institutions could contribute over there. Also, the short-term programs, which we do not utilize enough in terms of faculty development, could be held on campus here through the foreign universities and for the students' upgradation. The foreign, I think, institutionalization would do a lot of job over here. And as I think Professor Mantha was telling about short-term visits of the professors and all, I think it could be beneficial both the ways. If people take up the full semester teaching, that's another part. That's an ownership of a program which they are doing. Or they could be academic mentors abroad, and they could come for some personal contact lectures and all, and they could be contacted through e-mode as mentors. So we could have a larger collaboration. Now we are increasingly talking about making BOS and increasing the stakeholders' participation and all. And I think we should take valuable inputs from abroad rather than just being, you know, concentrating on our indigenous resources. I think one thing which need to be a little cautious about is about the pricing of the international programs. And I think here the cost of the task for regulation comes in, that where at what price, value-added price, you can offer a bouquet or range of courses to all streams in India, across India, and should not be only restricted to rural areas, to urban areas. It should be even to semi-urban and to rural areas. What are the possibilities of changing, say, irrigation modes, drip irrigation method, technology, getting them trained into that? So all these kinds of skill upgradation, I think we have not really tapped the international market at all. And I see a lot of scope over there. Thank you.
So there was a lot of mention about how we are facing currently a scenario where earlier there was a positive how many universities used to approach that we want to teach in your organization, in your universities. But there is an influx of a lot of foreign faculties now coming with the request, I'm open to teaching. So that's an interesting trend that we keep seeing. So there's no dearth of institutions wanting to come here. Having said that, there is a positive research which all of us agreed. But there is, even if you see, increasingly there is a lot of outsiders who are looking at India as an emerging economy, seeing that opportunity is actually about how models are getting disrupted, and if you do and test something in India, it'll work across the globe. So it's actually a part of a reverse innovation process, which people are saying, which Vijay Govindarajan, an innovation guru, was mentioning. So you have a Harvard or an MIT coming to do a research here in India and go to a Nashik Kumbhathon. Nothing stops us for us to take initiative at our end. We lack maybe the research capabilities, but definitely through collaboration or with partnering with some foreign institutions, you do try to raise your bar. So internationalization is important, but how we learn the ropes, better our own capabilities, and start solving our own problems. We don't want other institutions to come outside us to solve our problems. So there is a lot of potential for us to take the proactive stand to actually collaborate with industry or with academia, and with regular, you know, talking about NGOs or grassroots level of people. When you're talking about social sciences, increasingly problems are not necessarily restricted to one particular domain, be it engineering, IT, or marketing, or finance, or for that matter. So our education system, somewhere it is moving towards silos. We need to make it more broad-based into multidisciplinary and ensure that how we bring about this collaboration to happen. So if you're wanting an output of research, innovation, we need to have a dialogue between sciences, between different specializations to happen. And there is a gap, because generally what happens is people are looking to research in a particular domain and not necessarily collaborating across domains. So there is maybe an opportunity for us to look at that, how far we can bring that multidisciplinary approach to get maybe an outcome of a research or innovation or creation of new knowledge. Having said that, we are mentioning about partnerships. Yes, a lot of partnerships are at the very dormant stage. You just sign an MOU, have a couple of internships, and leave it at that. There are a lot of times when it goes beyond the helm, maybe at the from the top dean level or the director level, when it trickles down to a faculty and a student, then based on a research opportunity, you can have a long-term engagement. So when you're talking about teaching a full-time course or doing a project which is multicultural, multinational, then there's a long-term engagement. So we're not looking at internationalization merely from an internship or a visit tour or an international tour. It needs to be somebody having a long-term engagement, be it through some studies or a research angle attached to it. Then it becomes a win-win kind of a model. And where we also lack at our end in the Indian system is the IP, patents, and copyrights part of it. We need to really work on it. There are a lot of work being done. We do say, yeah, we lack the skills, but we do not have a necessary portal or a place where we can actually say, this is something which is IP, and how do I go about doing IP? Is there a central repository which helps me to actually patent my particular product? So there are a lot of scope for doing that, but we are not currently capitalizing on it. That's why we say we rank low on the in the research or the innovation index. So if you're even in the ranking part of it, India lacks, because we say our research input is something which is not there. And we're not looking to maybe aiming at the peer-reviewed journals or that output coming. And if you're looking at the national, we are saying we need to have inclusion, we need to have access. So somewhere the conflicting agenda somewhere pulls down. When you're looking at a Harvard, they're all looking at an Ivy League or elite crowd joining them. But if you're looking at a local college or a business school, you have diverse sector of people coming in. So how can we look to give the quality education at the same time raise our bar and look at research and innovation is a part to actually ponder upon.
Interdisciplinary research. Now, I'm currently in IIT. I know there are programs where you are exposed to social issues, and then students are made to work on it. But overall, generally, like for other fields, like art, science, commerce, they are not exposed to social issues. They do not know what is beyond Mumbai. What happens in Mumbai stays in Mumbai. They do not know that there is a big India exits, and you have so much opportunity to do research. Mumbai people look to US. If somebody is in rural India, will look towards, okay, I want to go to Mumbai. So that research thing, they have to look inward. So the students and faculty should be exposed to social issues, so that then they can come out with indigenous research, and then when we do our own research, then we'll be at par with other countries where they do their own research.
Thank you. My opinion about internationalization is that, you know, India is losing billions of dollars. Okay, because there is this one strata of society who can afford it, and they are sending them abroad. Why don't we save those billions of dollars and ensure that education, that kind of education, is available to us within our country? It saves them the boarding and lodging costs. So there would be greater degree of affordability, for there are so many people who cannot afford, can manage the tuition, but cannot go and stay there. So if we bring these institutions here, we collaborate in a manner whereby it is affordable. And I'm giving you my own college's example. We run summer programs with King's College London, and we do it at not even 1/4 the cost. So if it is a 2 lakhs or a 2.5 lakhs cost when the student goes there, the student here does it in 20,000 rupees. Now, that kind of a model, I think we should take an initiative and replicate these kind of things, because, and believe it or not, the feedback is that these courses are amazing. What they have not learned in their BCom courses, they have learned in these 15, 20 days of the summer program, is what they say. So why can't we do that? What is the harm in trying to bring in things, but at our cost? Universities are ready to come. We have collaborated with so many universities. We know they want to come. The problem with them is the kind of regulations that they have to face deters them from setting up campuses here. So if there is a little degree of that where we can enable them to come, we should ensure that, you know, and that would save India itself and give this kind of education which is needed by this country, as he rightly said, that, you know, there's going to be such a big skill gap. So I don't think we are capable of bridging that gap on our own. Why not we take something up like this? And secondly, when I'm saying we talk about digital India, why can't we have cross-border supply of services? Internet is something that is available to everybody, and so let's exploit that, let's use that. We have brought our faculty in HR college, everybody has been trained abroad. What I would suggest instead is that involves a more of a cost, because we've been supported by industry, so we could do that. Why don't we bring faculty, government is looking at it, why don't we bring foreign faculty to train our teachers? And those teachers use these skills in order to become better quality institutions. That's something that I think we need to look at. And I'm just going a little fast because time is running out. And we need to bring in flexibility in our courses. This kind of set pattern, interdisciplinary approach is what is absolutely needed. Our 4.0 GPA system must be a success if we have to be on par with the international world. Dual degree programs are something that we should look at. That within the 3 years that they have to study, they should be able to get dual degrees. That would give them the necessary skills, that would give them the necessary employability. And I repeat that for all this, industry has to be involved. We as academicians cannot do on our own what we feel like. We need to find out what the stakeholders need and be able to supply that, right? But I think this government's national institutional ranking framework is a good idea. It's a good initiative. And if it works well, then maybe we could also, you know, make Indian institutions come up to that level which is needed at the international, to meet international standards. Talking about research, I think our PhDs need to have a more rigorous process. We need that. Good theses should have some rewards. Where these rewards would be so that they can enhance their research. You know, these kind of reward systems are very important. There should be sharing of resources, research on common platforms, and enable students to learn from them. This sharing, like somebody rightly said, silos. We all of us work in silos. Why can't we share everything and use the multiplier effect to move forward? And we have these number of courses kind of system of examination. I think that has just killed creativity. That just finished innovation. That needs to change. Everybody's only talking about entrance exams. Where is the innovation? You're only concerned about that mechanical way of moving. That needs to change. There are about 60 central institutions which have started innovation clubs. Okay, and very successfully, there is interaction between academia and grassroots innovation. I think these kind of things should be spread around, and, you know, there should be a multiplier effect on all this. I'm not going to take more time because I can see.
I have a quick question. Sure. Quick comment.
I just want to point out that there is no regulation of academic system in the US universities. That is something I forgot to mention earlier. Each university is on its own. There is no regulation at all. The second thing that I want to mention is there is no special favors required for overseas institutions to come to India. At the same time, we don't need to block them. It's a free country. Let them come. Let them offer whatever they have best. If our students find it good, vis-a-vis other educational institutions in India as opposed to overseas, so they will go. Otherwise, if they don't do a good job, close shop. We don't have to give subsidized land. We don't have to enforce some of the rules. Let us give freedom to them. That may be good. So we don't need to show any special favors, but we don't have to block them either. That's what I would like to.
I am Hamza Sheikh. I'm pursuing my year of engineering in Mumbai, and I am representing Students Islamic Organization out here. And some of the points that I would like to put into the international scope out here is, before, you know, framing a policy, the first step should be, we should study some of the successful business models. Apart from that, educational models that the world is running. Mr. Mantha said, German model. We have a Qatar education city which is employing around 25 international elite universities in Qatar. So we study these models and then we devise from them what is a successful model for India. Because, you know, just copying someone is not applicable in India. The second point I would like to put is the international market is realizing the scope in India. And for that, they have their own funding programs and research work. Someone suggested the Kumbhathon. We have MIT Tata Center, which is on rural India. We have Tata Center in Bombay, which is focusing on rural India. So these are some of the more beneficial programs, like the Stanford India program cooperation aims in Delhi. And these programs are more good, and we should focus on frugal innovation, because we are a diverse crowd. We have a 1.2 billion crowd, which is a whole chunk of it is in rural India, and which has no amount of exposure in the international market. So we focus on frugal innovation, and we try to build up from there. That is one of my suggestions. These are the suggestions I would like to put. Thank you.
There was a request that was made by the organizers for us to give suggestions, and I don't think the time allows us to do this. What I would request the organizers is that if you circulate a summary of circulate the proceedings, each one of the participants could individually thereafter respond and provide suggestions, if that's okay with you. I just end with two very brief points. One is that there's a great book on Harvard University by a man called Clayton Christensen, and it's called The Innovative University. And he writes in that book that someone approached a businessman and said, can you just create a couple of world-class universities for us? And the Harvard chancellor at that stage said, there's absolutely no problem. I need $1 billion and 200 years. And I think this is a very critical thing, is that we don't realize that it is not off the shelf. It's a very critical question. The second, and I leave this as a thought, everyone is using the word internationalization. That is an amendment of a word called globalization. And globalization was used repeatedly at some point of time for us to be able to recognize that in a shrinking world, every commodity is up for trade. And education is a service up for trade. And therefore, it's a matter of whether we liberalize and open up, or we don't liberalize and don't open up. That's our choice. But if you want to participate in a global system, unfortunately, the choices are limited. Having said that, Thank you very much. It's been a great honor to interact with all of you and to be in the company of such distinguished persons. Thanks.